It's been about 17 years now. Started in 2003 when I moved to Sherbrooke from Toronto, and we had access to the PET imaging facilities where we could compare brain glucose and brain ketone metabolism. We didn't have the objective to find a treatment for Alzheimer's disease at the time. We wanted to explore what was happening with aging and to better understand whether both fuels were affected during aging, and we started to learn a lot of interesting things in the process. Well, I guess to be honest, we don't know. We know that the brain uses less glucose. It's hard to know whether the cells are having some problem to use the glucose. That appears to be the issue. But in the end, it's hard to say, because the imaging methods that we use look at the brain as a whole. And it's not clear which cells are having a problem. The neurovascular unit has several cell types besides the neurons. Is it the astrocytes that have the problem? Is it the neurons that have the problem? Is the problem actually starting with the capillaries that bring the glucose to the brain? These are things that are unclear. The only thing that is emerging from our work is that whatever the problem with glucose is, it seems to be specific to glucose because it doesn't affect ketones. So this is the thing that we are building the clinical trials around. Well, strictly speaking, your question means, can we improve glucose uptake in the brain of someone with mild cognitive impairment? Actually, exercise seems to improve brain glucose uptake a little bit. We've studied this in a preliminary way. We don't have extensive data on this. What seems to be more effective is to bypass the problem with glucose and use the ketones, for which there doesn't seem to be any problem at all. And so in the end, probably something that supplies ketones plus exercise should give us a beneficial effect, a little bit at least for glucose and perhaps a bit more for ketones, so that we get a little bit more effect from the level of supplement that needs to be provided. Yes, MCT is a generic term, and it includes fatty acids that are quite ketogenic, like C8, caprylic acid, but are moderately ketogenic, like C10, caproic acid. But as you go into other medium-chain triglyceride fatty acids, like C12, C14, they're essentially not ketogenic at all. So this is difficult. MCT are available in health food shops, and people can buy them in most countries. But it's not clear whether they're buying the equivalent product, even though they're all called MCT. So this is a bit of a challenge. But in some cases, there's a certification that's available for the product that it contains a certain amount of C8. And that's important to know. If you're looking for the ketogenic effect, it's important to verify that the contents will actually be ketogenic. Yeah, so our studies are addressing mild cognitive impairment. And the purpose of starting at that stage of the disease is to try and stop it from getting too severe. The challenge is that the problem is not too severe yet. So that means that there's only a mild deficit, and being able to show that you've corrected a mild deficit is harder to show than if you're correcting a major deficit. So there's an advantage of starting in mild cognitive impairment, but there's also a challenge associated with it. And we're simply trying to test various ketogenic supplements to see what is the most effective way to correct the brain energy deficit or the brain energy gap and improve the chances of improving cognition. So this may be that MCT is the best product available. It may be that more ketogenic supplements will be developed and will be assessed. This takes stringent studies. They need to be fairly long. With cognitive studies, you absolutely need to have a placebo because there's a fair amount of interaction between the person who's taking the test and the person who's administering the test. So there's a degree of subjectivity that has to be corrected for, canceled out. And the only way to do that is with a placebo. And at the moment, this has not been done very often. So we're quite proud of having been able to accomplish this in a 6-month trial. And we certainly hope that others will join us and push forward with these types of randomized controlled trials in MCI.